Good morning, UUFLB. My name's Karen Marcus, and I'll be your lay leader for this morning's service. It's Easter Sunday, but it's also the time of the celebration and observance of Passover and the season of Ramadan. And that makes it a special day when these three faith traditions intersect. And if that wasn't enough, the earth is also telling us we're in a time of transition from winter into springtime. And all of these will be themes touched upon during the service today. So as I get our slides up, I would like to remind you that you'll want to put your Zoom controls into speaker view. And I'll also remind you that I'm flying solo again today, which means that I'll apologize in advance for any audiovisual synchronization issues. Hopefully the internet gods will smile upon us. But today we welcome you. We know you come here for different reasons, to find community, to seek your spiritual and personal truths, to question, to nurture your heart and soul, to be nurtured, to explore new ideas, to find comfort, and perhaps to find the answers to some of your bigger questions. We welcome you to our Zoom cyberspace. We know you come from different places, different religions, different beliefs, and different backgrounds. Here at UUFLB, we hope you'll find comfort, connection, challenge, inspiration, and most of all, love. We're so glad you joined us this morning and hope you'll stay a few minutes after the service for fellowship and conversation. Our touchstone theme for the month of April is theological reflection. Because theology in our tradition is not prescribed, it's incumbent upon each of us to build our own theology. By doing so, we create a more reliable internal compass that orients us to our true north. And by doing so, we're better able to align our actions with our values. Theological reflection is an essential process to identify first principles, clarify values, take seriously that which we do not believe, explore those ideas that make us uncomfortable and/or challenge us, and ensure that our beliefs are life-enhancing. As Rilke said, sometimes it's necessary to live the questions in order to experience the answer on some distant day. Theological reflection is a lifelong endeavor. We're joined again today by the Reverend Connie Simon. As you know her, she was during her first year in Meadville Theological School from 2015 to 2016. She served as our resident speaker at UUFLB. And following an internship at the Unitarian Society of Germantown, she was co-ordained by USG and the First Unitarian Church of Philadelphia, and then was called by the First Unitarian Church of Cincinnati in 2018. It's nice to have her with us from afar. Committed to supporting each of us, finding our inner divine, she describes her ministry as helping people heal from the inside out so they can do the outside in work of our world that is needed so desperately. The topic of her sermon today is titled, So Shall We Rise. Are you feeling weary? After 2 years, we still haven't shaken the pandemic. The political discord, injustice, and violence continue. So it's easy to feel down. Be encouraged, friend. Just as the earth is reborn in spring, so shall we rise. Now, let us enter into worship together. Avi has prepared a contemporary song by Tom Petty for our opening song, Learning to Fly.
Good morning. We start with a song this morning by Tom Petty to lift us up. Learning to Fly. Well, I started out down a dirty road. sought it out.
Thank you, Avi, for introducing at least me to a new song. I wasn't familiar with that one. So I took a few minutes and I listened to it again, and I even read the lyrics, and I still wasn't quite sure what the message of that song was. So I wanted to share something with you. In an interview, Tom Petty said, this song was written about 4 years after an arsonist destroyed his home by fire. And he also said it was inspired by something a pilot had told him, that the hardest part about flying is coming down. So he was quoted in the interview as saying, everyone has tragedy in their life. You can lay down and let the tragedy overwhelm you, or you can fly above it. And I think that's sort of what I'm trying to say in that song. I don't say that I can fly, I'm learning. Also, we're often expected to do a lot of things that we're not necessarily equipped for. So again, Avi, we thank you for introducing us to that music. And now let us light our chalice. And speak these words with me. We light this chalice as a beacon of hope for those who have gathered here today, for all those who have walked through our doors, and for those who may yet find this spiritual home, and for those whose paths will never come our way. For all this, and for all those things we dare to hope and dream, we kindle our chalice flame this day. Our opening words for this morning's service are from the Reverend Allison Waller. With thankful hearts, we come together this morning to celebrate the bounty of the day, to bask in the warmth of this community, to share with friends the tides of our lives, to entertain perennially our hopes for a better future. We join together this morning, as always, to resist injustice and inequality, wherever they may be found. Our hearts are touched by the human need we feel around us, whether far away or within reach of our hand. We come here to be together, because this is how we believe our lives are best lived, in questioning and in conversation, in compassion and in service, in gratitude and in joy, in companionship and in love. It is good to be together with you this morning. Amen. And now Beck Stau has a message for all ages that is quite seasonal.
Good morning, and thank you for joining us today. I'm Beck Stau, and our message for all ages this morning is Goodbye Winter, Hello Spring by Kennard Pack. Hello, winter night. Hello, snow. Hello, from high up in the sky, I drift down, 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 down. I fall through the sycamore branches. I fall onto a husky's bushy tail. Hello, frozen pond. Hello, sleeping fish. Hello, we huddle for a winter's sleep. Over our frozen ceiling, the wind sweeps away snowy dust. Hello, glass house. Hello, I'm cold inside. The swaying trees through my glass panels are like tall, slender ghosts. The last logs are draped with snow. Hello, winter brook. Hello. Rocks and sticks are frozen in the ice along my curving banks. Hello, footprints in the snow. Hello. We disappear as the snow covers us. Hello, trees. Hello. Our thin arms shudder and lash in the rising snowstorm. Hello, empty nest. Hello. Against the striking winds, my twigs stay together. Hello, winter storm. I howl. Good morning, orange-soaked hills. Good morning, we glow at dawn. Hello, early light. I illuminate everything around you. Hello, slush and snow. Hello. In the sunlight, I soak into the cold ground. In the shadow, I stay still and icy. Hello, winter thaw. Hello, new leaves. Hello, waking animals. Hello, bright sun. I warm the land. Hello, budding flowers. Hello, bright blue pond. Hello, running brook. Hello, green grass all over. Hello, robins. Hello, our petals blossom. The fish are awake. Streams run down the hills. Morning dew is on the meadows. The birds have come back. Goodbye, winter. Hello, spring.
What a great story, and it's what we're experiencing right now. So thanks to Bex for bringing that to us. And now Avi returns with a musical interlude, which is one of my favorite songs by Simon and Garfunkel, Bridge Over Troubled Waters.
Feeling small.
I will dry them all.
Thank you, Avi. As I said, I love that song. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Reverend Connie for reading.
Our reading for today is After He Is Risen by Joshua Mason Powellek. After the hosannas have all been shouted, after anguished moments in the garden have been spent, after take this bread and eat, take this wine and drink, after betrayal with a kiss, after hands washed and 39 lashes, after 7 last words and he breathed his last, after crucifixion and death, after laying the body in the tomb, after rolling away the stone, after proclamations of he is risen, now let us rise. Now let us awaken to a new dawn, a new day. Let us remake the world with the hope of Easter. Let us free the prisoners, house the homeless, educate the children, offer gainful work to all who are willing and able to work, protect soil, water, air, and food, and all forms of state-sanctioned violence. Now may we awaken and stay woke. Now may we rise and stay risen. Amen and blessed be.
That is a great reading, and it foreshadows her message today. But at this moment, we want to pause and think about our gifts and how we want to share them. As you know, for the last couple of months, we've been supporting the efforts in Ukraine to help the children who are being so radically affected by what's going on there. Save the Children is a program that is concerned for those who are caught in the middle of this armed conflict and forced from their homes in freezing temperatures, exposed to injury, hunger, and cold. Our donations over these past couple of months to Save the Children's Ukraine Crisis Relief Fund are helping to provide immediate aid. So please be a part of this effort by contributing as generously as possible. It is a very important humanitarian effort, and we thank you for your generosity. And now Reverend Connie will return with her message. So shall we rise.
I have lots of fond memories of Easter Sunday. Those big family dinners of my childhood when all my aunts, uncles, and cousins would travel to my Grandma Hattie's house for the day. Those times in college when there was a crush of students who couldn't wait to get out of the dorms and flood planes, trains, and automobiles to whatever place they called home. And even now, as an adult, when I look forward to traveling back to the Philadelphia area to be with my loved ones. Lots and lots of Easter memories. But those were before COVID. Do you remember where we were just 2 years ago at Easter? Some new superbug called the coronavirus had stricken almost 2 million people worldwide and taken the lives of over 100,000 people. And there were more than 500,000 cases in this country. And I remember thinking and hearing how that was so many people. Businesses were closed. Employees had their hours cut. They were furloughed or they were just completely laid off. The stock market tanked, leaving retirement accounts decimated. Children hadn't been in school for weeks and were learning at home. Sporting events, festivals, and concerts were canceled. Churches and community centers were closed. This time 2 years ago, all
I am told that Mike's out there actually listening to what's going on, and he says that this sermon is like even locking up. I don't know if that's universally true for everybody, but what I am going to do is try to go back in and click on that setting that allows the audio and visual to sync up better so that you're not distracted. It's an important message that Reverend Connie has. So give me just a moment to get that done and to get the sermon restarted. And I appreciate your patience.
Fifty states had declared emergencies as we ended our fourth week of hunkering down in our homes. And when we did make that brave and scary decision to go outside, we wore masks and practiced physical distancing. Besides making us sick and taking lives, COVID-19 brought out the worst in us. Remember the shopper in Australia who pulled a knife on another shopper in a fight over toilet paper? Or the stories that we would hear almost every day about people hoarding hand sanitizer. Remember, you couldn't even find a can of Lysol to save your life. There were stories of people deliberately coughing on produce in grocery stores in an effort to I don't even know what they were trying to do. As the number of cases climbed in this country, so too did the number of cases of racism against Asian Americans. Californian Yan Yang Zhu told the New York Times about an incident that had happened right before Easter 2020. She was walking to her gym when she noticed that a man was shouting at her. He was yelling an expletive about China. Then a bus passed and he screamed after it, "Run them over!" She tried to keep her distance, but when the light changed, she was stuck waiting with him at the crosswalk. She could feel him staring at her. And then suddenly she felt it, his saliva hitting her face and her favorite sweater. In shock, Miss Zhu, who's 26 and moved to the United States from Chicago just 5 years earlier, hurried the rest of the way to the gym. She found a corner where no one could see her, and she cried quietly. "That person didn't look strange or anything, you know," she said of her tormentor. "He just looked like a normal person." I wish I could say that's all in the past, but I can't. Hate crimes continue to rise against Asian Americans, fueled in large part by the xenophobic rhetoric of the former president. The San Francisco Police Department reported in January 2022 that anti-Asian bias incidents jumped 567% from 2020 to 2021. Yes, 567%. And they think it's probably higher than that because most of the cases go unreported. And it's not just San Francisco. The numbers are up in New York, Los Angeles, Chicago, and other large cities, with one of the worst incidents being the March 2021 rampage against Atlanta massage parlors in which six Asian women were murdered. Jack Chin, a professor at UC Davis Law School, recently said, "We had a campaign and administration that openly appealed to racial resentment and xenophobia. The administration was repudiated in the election, but that didn't go away just because Trump lost." No, it didn't go away. COVID-19 exposed some ugly truths about our society, about all kinds of parts of our society, more than I could discuss today. But let's look at health. The data shows that while people of color weren't more likely to be infected by coronavirus, we were more likely to be admitted to the ICU or to die of it. Sadly, I know this from my own family. Dr. Anthony Fauci cited the prevalence of underlying medical conditions such as diabetes, hypertension, obesity, and asthma, and pleaded with us over the last couple of years to address the health disparities that exist in the U.S. It only makes sense if we hope to avoid these heavy losses of life when the next superbug emerges. COVID-19 exposed the depth of poverty and economic insecurity in this country as well. At the start of the pandemic, 69% of Americans had less than $1,000 in savings. According to Bankrate, about a third of the population owed more on their credit cards than they had in savings. A service by Willis Towers Watson found that almost 20% of people making more than $100,000 a year were still living paycheck to paycheck. The facade of middle class economic stability cracked. And it's still cracked and broken. Ben Castleman of the New York Times noted in February that the pandemic's grip on the economy appears to be loosening. Job growth and retail spending were strong in January 2022, even as coronavirus cases hit a record. New York, Massachusetts, and other states have begun to lift indoor mask mandates, he says. Yet, the economy remains far from normal. Patterns of work, socializing, and spending disrupted by the pandemic have been slow to readjust. Prices are rising at their fastest pace in four decades, and there are signs that inflation is creeping into a broader range of products and services. In surveys, Americans report feeling gloomier about the economy now than at the height of the lockdowns and job losses in the first weeks of the crisis. If you've been in the grocery store lately, if you've tried to buy a new home lately, you know that this is the truth. That prices are rising rapidly, and that it's difficult for many to make ends meet. And as far as it is, as hard as it is for those in the middle class, it's been even harder for the people who are underemployed, trying to get by on low-paying jobs, struggling to pay food, rent, and utility expenses, struggling to cover just the basics. The grocery stores, the cashiers, the custodians, the maintenance workers, the people that we referred to as heroes early on, the people we thanked for staying at their posts and serving us. Many of those folks didn't have a choice. They didn't have savings. They didn't work. They didn't eat. That hasn't changed 2 years later. That's still the case. It's been a tough time. We're not sure what comes next. All we talk about is getting back to normal, but we don't know when that's going to happen or even what normal will be. To quote Eric Pevernaggi, we feel the world is slipping out of our hands and recognize that the core of our conceived blueprint is escaping us. And here we are. Here we are at the intersection of two major but very different religious holidays. It is Passover, the celebration of the end of slavery and hardship for the Jews in Egypt, the celebration of their covenant with God. During Passover, Moses warned the Egyptian Pharaoh that God would bring 10 plagues upon the oppressors of the Jews. The last of these was the death of every firstborn child of Egypt. The houses of the faithful Jews were passed over and their children saved. In this most holy time, I've heard more than one rabbi question whether COVID represents the 11th plague. And it's Easter, the celebration of the resurrection of Jesus. This Christian celebration establishes Jesus as the Son of God and assures believers that those with faith will receive eternal salvation. As it says in John 5, verses 28 through 29, do not be astonished at this, for the hour is coming when all who are in their graves will hear his voice and come out. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation. For our Jewish and Christian friends, their faith will carry them through these hard times. But what about the rest of us? What about Unitarian Universalists? Most UUs don't believe in religious miracles of the Bible, don't believe that the plagues happened or that Jesus was resurrected. Many UUs don't want to have anything to do with miracle stories and shut down in disgust at the mere mention of the R word. And by that, I mean resurrection. But I will say to you this morning that there is meaning in both these traditions for us too, if we can open our hearts and our minds to receive it. Resurrection comes from the Latin word meaning to rise again. We shall be resurrected from COVID-19, from all the things that plague us now, from war, from racism, from violence, from oppression, just as the dormant earth returns to life in the spring. 19th century Christian socialist and reformer Charles Kingsley wrote, "See the land her Easter keeping rises as her maker rose. Seed so long in darkness sleeping burst at last from winter snows." Despite all that is happening, and with no intervention on our part, spring is here. The flowers and the trees don't know about pandemics and economic instability and war and racism. Nature is doing what it does, rising again because it's spring. It's the cycle of life. We shall rise again, just like the earth. There are some other R words that come to mind on this day. One is reminder. As I think of the physical, emotional, and economic devastation that's happening all over the globe, I am reminded of the old adage attributed both to Persian Sufi poets and to Jewish folklore, that this too shall pass. This situation, our entire lives, are but a blip in the big picture of time. It will end. Our lives will end. The situation we find ourselves in now will end. Even with COVID, we've discovered vaccines. Many have developed immunity. The virus may disappear as quickly as it came. Somehow, some way, someday, the pandemic will end. Now, just as COVID has brought out the worst in us, it's also brought out the best in us. We are renewing our relationships and re-establishing connection with one another and to the earth. Even when we couldn't physically visit with our friends and neighbors, we made phone calls and video chats and texts. Even if we're not traveling and vacationing as much as we're used to, we're figuring out how to reconnect with ourselves and with our friends, families, and neighbors. We're seeing less focus on individualism and more on our duty and responsibility to one another. Healthcare workers and first responders gave us examples of that every single day. Police officers, firefighters, paramedics, nurses, doctors, and healthcare workers who were on the front lines of helping the sick, exposing themselves to this disease in the process. They taught us what responsibility to the greater community is all about. Many essential workers, such as garbage collectors, grocery workers, and delivery people, shared that sense of responsibility, even though some, as I said earlier, were doing it because they had no choice. We practiced social distancing. We stayed at home. We weren't gathering in large groups, and we're still not doing it completely yet, but we're getting vaccinated. We're doing our part for our larger community. Together, we slowed the deluge of the coronavirus. It's not completely gone, but we've slowed it down because we finally figured out that we really are all in this together. We are resilient. We've returned before from situations and conditions that seemed insurmountable. The 1918 flu pandemic, the Great Depression, World War II, 9/11, and acts of global terrorism. We've come back before and we will again. We are resilient and we are creative. We are figuring out new ways of doing things. There was a time when we only saw people on TV from studios and in filmed situations, but now TV news and talk show programs and presenters and guests come to us live from all kinds of remote locations. We see them in their homes. We see them with their kids running around in the backgrounds. I used Zoom on a weekly basis for 3 years during seminary years ago, but never imagined in a million years that I'd be leading worship this way on a regular basis. I know there are some things that technology can't replace, and that many, many weddings, memorials, and other mass celebrations have been canceled, postponed, or scaled back. Still, we're finding ways to connect with one another, to celebrate and to share with one another. We are resilient and we are creative. Encouraged by these reminders, guided by our resilience and responsibility and our relationships, so shall we rise. One day we won't have to be quarantined because we've been exposed to someone with COVID. We'll stop wearing masks completely. So shall we rise, but not back to what we were. As a society, we have been changed. We can't go back to what we were. We will be different. My prayer is that we will be better. Hopefully, we will be kinder to ourselves and to others. So shall we rise to do the work of justice, to correct the inequities and problems of our society, to eliminate poverty, income inequality, racism, and homelessness, not just to talk about it, but to do the real work of dismantling the systemic injustices that have been so deeply rooted in our society for far too long. So shall we rise, determined not to let this be a temporary period of love and cooperation, but rather a permanent way of being with one another. As Scotty McLennan writes, we need to be open to resurrection, looking up, not down, listening, not stopping up our ears, tasting before we swallow, smelling the flowers, not passing them by, feeling deeply rather than numbing ourselves with the daily routine. So shall we rise with renewed hope, courage, and faith in ourselves and each other. May it be so.
Thank you, Reverend Connie. Give me just a second here. I don't know if you were like me, but I felt that rise from the depth of despair in the early part of her message to the message of hope at the end. So we do appreciate her recording that message for us so that we could experience it this morning. At this time, though, we want to pause before we close our service and listen to the joys and sorrows of this community. If you wish to share something, it's best if you could go to your Zoom controls, click on reactions, and raise your electronic hand. That puts you at the top of the participant list and helps me to be able to identify you quickly so that I can help you unmute. But if that's not something you're able to do at this moment, and you wish to just wave your physical hand, make sure your camera is activated, otherwise I can't see you. Is there anyone who would like to share this morning? I think I see Bill. You should be able to unmute now, Bill. There you go.
You see, I have a mask on today, and that's to make sure that I protect Nancy as much as possible, as I have a positive COVID test on Friday. And it's been a rough several days that I've been going through this. So for us, it's not over yet. And several of my friends here have also contracted it. Who knows how or when, but we're dealing with it. So we're not going to Lancaster to be with our family today. But Debbie's going to stop by and bring us some leftovers from the great ham dinner that I'm missing. But I wanted to share that with you. This thing is not over yet, and I hope that nobody gets it. I've never been this sick as I've been these last 3 or 4 days.
Well, we're sorry to hear that, Bill. And I know everybody in this community wishes you and Nancy well as your fellows, members of the community where you live. So we hope you recover fully and soon. Anyone else? We're a quiet bunch this morning. Well, if there's no one else who would like to share, and I apologize if I've overlooked someone, but let's take a moment. If yours was a joy, I hope you feel like we're celebrating with you. If yours was a sorrow, whether spoken or unspoken, we hope that you feel our compassion and our sympathy. And for all those joys and sorrows, and in particular for Bill and Nancy, let's take a moment for silent reflection and prayer. And now Avi returns to give us our closing song, a familiar hymn. You might want to sing along.
Please join me in our closing hymn, number 169, We Shall Overcome. We shall overcome some. my heart, I do believe that we shall overcome someday. We'll walk hand in hand, we'll walk hand in hand, we'll walk hand in hand someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe that we'll walk hand in hand someday. We shall all be free, we shall all be free.
And now we'll extinguish our chalice. We extinguish this chalice flame, daring to carry forward the vision of this free faith that freedom, reason, and justice will one day prevail in this nation and across the earth. That concludes our service. Give me a second. We will stop our projection and I'll go to the security session so that you can all unmute and do the chat, but let's continue in conversation with one another.